I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then we're going to do a little review and jump right in and see if we remember where we're at. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for your presence that's here. We thank you, Lord, that you're alive. You're not dead. You're not just an ideology or a religion or an idea, but you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You are our risen Savior who is alive, reigning in heaven with the Father even now. And we thank you, God, the Holy Spirit, that you are here with us, that you have become the helper and taken Jesus's place here in the work and ministry of the church. And I pray, Holy Spirit, Spirit of Christ, that you would illuminate our minds that are so darkened by sin at times, but Lord, give us understanding, soften our hearts, help us to receive your truth, help us to grow in grace and knowledge this evening. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So the title tonight, we're really looking at the life and call of Abraham. And if you look at how far we've come, we've actually covered quite a bit of ground in the book of Genesis. You remember the first four events and then the four major biographies. That's the whole book of Genesis. So who can name all four major events in order? Very good. Okay, got that. Creation, fall, flood, Tower of Babel. Those are the four major events. What about the four major biographies, the character studies that Moses takes us in? Rosie?
Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Jacob.
Good. Just flip the last two. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then Joseph. All right, so those are the major studies. We've already covered the Tower of Babel, which was last week. So let me ask you a few review questions on that that'll help us get our bearings and see why we're even talking about Abraham tonight. First question, where did Noah and his sons initially live after leaving the ark when it came to rest? Where was that geographically? Okay, in the mountains. Anybody remember the region of mountains? The mountains of? Jenny?
Ararat,
correct. Okay, so they're kind of mountain living, but then they end up moving all of humanity. Remember, it was through Noah's sons. They began to grow, and they started to transition from the mountain living to down on the land. But one of the questions I have is, why does Moses focus on the sons of Ham more than the sons of Shem or Japheth in Genesis 10? Why is his focus on Ham? Why is that important? Don?
Because of the land of Canaan.
Very good. We have that really weird event that happens at the beginning of 10. You know, at the end of 9, Noah and his sons and their wives and the animals leave the ark. Noah worships the Lord, but then Noah, he needs a job. And he decides to make a vineyard, makes wine, gets drunk. That really, then he's naked in his tent. Really weird event. You're going, why is this even in the Bible? Why is it in the Bible? What is it? What's the focus there that Moses gives us? Which son, Jeff?
Because they had to enter the land of Canaan.
Right. So out of the three sons of Noah, Ham is the one whose son is Canaan, and Noah ends up cursing Ham's son Canaan and saying that he is now going to dwell in the tents of Shem and Japheth, that he's not going to have his own land, basically. And Moses is writing to the Jews who are about to enter which land?
Canaan.
Land of Canaan. So they're getting some historical background going, oh, that's why we're going into the land of Canaan, because of what Ham did to his father Noah, because God's promise and God's blessing on Shem and not on Ham, and especially not on Canaan. Who did God promise the land of Canaan to first? The only record we have of that land being promised to someone. Who was it? Rosie?
Abraham.
We're going to read tonight how Abraham leaves Ur of the Chaldeans to go sojourn, which means to basically travel, be a a foreigner, a nomad for a time in the land of Canaan. And God promises, he says, I'm going to make you a great nation, and I'm going to give you the land of your sojournings. I'm going to give you the place where you've been dwelling as a foreigner. It will become your land and the land of your descendants. What geographical landscape did all the people of the world settle in to build a city and a tower? Okay, that's present day, but what do they call it in the Bible of that day? Babel? There's actually quite a few cities that were started by one of Ham's sons, Nimrod. Does anybody remember what was significant about Nimrod?
Well, I was going to say Shinar.
Okay, yeah, the plains of Shinar. It says that Nimrod, it describes him in a few ways. What he did, who he was, and what he did. Does anybody remember what's significant about this guy named Nimrod? He was a really smart individual. He was just such a Nimrod, right? Have some weird kind of insults we give to people.
He grew to be a warrior.
Okay. First person that says he was a mighty man and a mighty hunter before the Lord. Why is that significant? Because before this, there was no armies, militaries, nations. There was not the killing of people in battle. And there wasn't the killing of animals for food. Now, after the flood, those two things are reality. The just killing in battle that happens and the killing of animals for food. Nimrod kind of summarized both of those. And it says he started a kingdom in the plains of Shinar. One of the areas he started was Babel. And that's where we get the term, because the Tower of Babel, why are you just babbling on and on? Right? Makes sense? Because of the nonsense language that sometimes people speak? David, did you have something?
No.
You sure? I'm going to just keep staring at you until you give me an answer. Yeah, I sometimes, I'm going to, but I don't. I give the answer, so that's what happened. So why did the post-flood people build a city and a tower? Scripture gives us their reason. Why did they build a city and a tower in the plains of Shinar? Gary? Okay, they wanted to reach the heavens, but what was their purpose in it? Sorry, what was that? Yeah. I'm like, what is... Why is Siri talking to me? She seriously answered my question. I have not put that setting on. I have never done that. And I think when I said Shinar, it came out as Siri, and I'm like, who's talking? So I was about to kick somebody out of here. But I'm just kidding. So, Dan, one more time. Yeah, you're babbling. That was good. Right. Isn't that interesting? They wanted to make a name for themselves. That doesn't sound proud, does it? All right, let's make a name for ourselves. Let's build the tallest tower we can up into the heavens so we're not dispersed. And God's like, guess what? Getting dispersed. Like, shouldn't have done that. Shouldn't have got filled with your pride trying to take God out of the picture. And what happens when man tries to take God out of the picture? All kinds of problems, right? I mean, imagine if your kids tried to take you as a parent out of the picture. You think you're going to lay down and let that happen? Nope. And so God's kids, God's not too happy with what his children were doing in the plains of Shinar. It's kind of like that, okay, this is totally off track, and I meant to mention it last week. But it's kind of a weird contemporary version of the Tower of Babel, in my opinion. Burning Man. Have you heard of this festival? Out in the desert in the boonies, people come from all over. They set up a makeshift city. There's no currency. You got to bring in your food, your water, all the necessities for this. I think it's a week-long festival or whatever. First thing they do is they build this huge statue out of wood or other things, that at the end of the festival, they burn the whole thing and dance around it. And the whole week, you barter for your necessities. No money. So they barter everything from other goods to services to sexual trading, to the point where there's a tent and it's the orgy tent. And it's just, you just go have sex with all these strangers. And this is what the young people of today, it's like they're even more extreme version of Woodstock. And it's like, oh, let's have our own. And they have this weird festival. It's like, build this thing and we'll dance around it like a bunch of heathens and pagans. And you get young people, some who are even Christians, going, oh man, I want to go to Burning Man so bad. Really? Yeah, it's probably a good thing. Sorry I ruined that for you. I corrupted your pure and... Yeah, if your kids or grandkids say, hey, I want to go to Burning Man, say no and lock them in their room. But because they're going to come back with things they don't want to come back with. And I'm being honest, like reality is. And I mean, clothing is optional, of course, in a setting like that. It's just, it's not good. And so you had the people in the plains of Shinar thinking, hey, let's erect this big thing and make a name for ourselves. But when the divine building inspector came down, what conclusion did God make? What did he say about this city and this tower? Or about mankind specifically is actually what he references. Anybody? Rosie?
That as long as they were united like that and all together with one language, nothing would be impossible.
Nothing would be impossible for man when he is united with one language and one purpose. And if he's corrupted and in the sinful nature without anything being impossible, that's a pretty dangerous situation for humanity and the world itself, right? And so God comes down, he confuses their language, and this is where the nations come from. That's why this passage is called the Table of Nations, because there was just one people at that time, all from Noah and his wife and Noah and his sons, and then they all spread out and you have them settling, Shem settling in his area, Ham in his area, and Japheth in his. And that's where we get all the nations and people groups from today. So last week was really the cursing of Ham's son Canaan and the creation of the nations. But this week, we look at the calling and blessing of Shem's descendant, Abraham. So let's go ahead and look at Genesis 11, starting at verse 10. This is right after the Tower of Babel, and notice it's going to be Shem's descendants now. So why don't you stand with me, and we'll make this genealogy really exciting. No, I know you love them, like you crack them, you're like, oh, devotional in the morning, Lord, I really want to get into your word, let's read Shem's descendants. Yes. So, but it's always there for a reason, correct? I'll give you a highlight. Look for the names Terah and Abram. Because the whole reason this lineage is given is to lead us to them. All right? So these are the generations of Shem. When Shem was 100 years old, he fathered Arpachshad 2 years after the flood. And Shem lived after he fathered Arpachshad for 500 years and had other sons and daughters. Now it goes off unto his son. When Arpachshad had lived for 35 years, he fathered Shelah. And Arpachshad lived after he fathered Shelah for 403 years and had other sons and daughters. When Shelah had lived for 30 years, he fathered Eber. And Shelah lived after he fathered Eber for 403 years and had other sons and daughters. When Eber had lived for 34 years, he fathered Peleg. You can see this is a family tree, right? You start with one, and then his son, and then his son had this son, and it keeps going down until we get to Terah. And Peleg lived after he fathered Reu for 209 years and had other sons and daughters. Do you see the years decreasing? From when they start having kids, it was in the hundreds, and now it's getting into the 30s. And how long they lived after they had kids, it was in the 403, and then it's 209. It all keeps scaling down. When Peleg had lived for 30 years, he fathered Reu, and Peleg lived after he fathered Reu for 209 years and had other sons and daughters. And when Reu had lived 32 years, he fathered Serug, and Reu lived after he fathered Serug for 207 years and had other sons and daughters. When Serug had lived for 30 years, he fathered Nahor, and Serug lived after he fathered Nahor for 200 years and had other sons and daughters. When Nahor had lived for 29 years, he fathered Terah, and Nahor lived after he fathered Terah for 119 years and had other sons and daughters. When Terah had lived for 70 years, he fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Three sons from Terah. Noah had three sons, correct? It's interesting that all three sons are mentioned here, because Abram and specifically Haran are going to play into the picture here. Nahor, there's not a lot said about him. So let's look at verse 27. Now, these are the generations of Terah. Now, notice, back in verse 10, it said these are the generations of Shem. That's the focus. Now, Moses is taking one guy from Shem's lineage and saying, now these are the generations of Terah. So now we're getting closer and more focused. He says, Terah fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran fathered Lot. Everybody remember Lot from the Old Testament? Okay, so Abram is brothers with Haran, who has a son named Lot. Okay, Lot is Abram's nephew. Haran died in the presence of his father Terah in the land of his kindred in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Abram and Nahor took wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife, Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah and Ishka. Now Sarai was barren. She had no child. Terah took Abram his son, and Lot the son of Haran his grandson, and Sarai his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. You can be seated. We're going to stop there for a minute and start to look at it piece by piece. But if you remember, back in Genesis 10, when Moses starts writing about the sons of Noah, his focus at that point is Ham. He mentions the genealogy of Shem and Japheth, but his focus is Ham. Now, Moses goes back to Shem, and he ignores Ham, and he ignores Japheth. But Shem is the one that is most important for him, because it is the descendant of Shem, Abraham, who all the Israelites came through. When we get the term Semitic, when you say somebody's anti-Semitic, or somebody who has anti-Jewish sentiments or beliefs, that word Semitic comes from the word Shem, okay? Or the Shemites, or Semites. And so that's where it comes from. So any of the people who came from Shem would fit into that category, because Abraham was one of his descendants. That is why Shem is in focus right now. When we look at Genesis 11, 10 through 32, Moses just wants the people of Israel to know where they came from and who Abraham is and why God called him out of the nations. And that's a very important point with Abram in his life, is that all the nations were spread out. No nation was serving the Lord. And in the midst of that pagan world, God set aside one man for himself. Didn't he do that with someone else already in the Old Testament? Noah, right? All the world had done evil, turned to evil. Their hearts and minds were continually conceiving evil. And God graciously pulls Noah out of the world, shows him grace, gives him a command and a promise, and then Noah does what God commands and receives the promise. Same mode of operation when God deals with Abraham. He takes one man out of fallen humanity and graciously calls him to himself. He gives him a command, he gives him a promise, and then Abraham does what God commanded and receives the promise. Do you see how that works? So is there a parallel for you and me? That God calls you out of sinful humanity to say, come, believe in my son, receive him. And because of God's grace, you are brought into a relationship with him where God gives you a command to believe on Christ and walk in his ways. He gives you a promise that if you do that, you will receive eternal life and be with him forever and be forgiven of all your sins. And then what would God expect you to do? Go and do it. And so what we see in Abraham tonight is a guy who had a faith that propelled him towards obedience. And sometimes we in our church culture claim a faith, but that faith we have, there is no desire for obedience in that person who claims faith. We want the ticket to heaven, but we don't want to walk the road that takes us there. Ever thought of that? If it required walking a road of righteousness, I wonder how many people would still want to do it. But doesn't it? We're not saved by the way that we walk, but we believe in the one who walked that road for us, and we are called to follow in his footsteps. Because we're all following someone. Everybody is. No matter how much of a natural-born leader you are following someone. Something, some ideology, some belief system, or your own desires. And if you're following your own desires, good grief. You're going to just destroy yourself from the inside out. But you follow the Lord, his kingdom, his desires, you're going to be blessed. I've been going through the book of Proverbs with the kids before school every morning. And we're on Proverbs 9 tomorrow. And I had to talk to, you know, when you have a range of ages as kids, you got to figure out how to kind of connect with them and communicate God's word. And I'm telling you, communicating God's word to a six-year-old up to a 12-year-old at the same time early in the morning is way more difficult than talking to you guys. Because one's like banging on the table and one's doing, you know, and they're getting it more and more. But it's interesting because when you have to break something down more simply, it really shows what ability or lack of ability you have to teach, because you have to make it make sense. And trying to explain wisdom to my kids, I'm like, okay, what is wisdom and why would you want it? Wisdom is understanding and knowing the right path to take. That's what wisdom is, having that understanding. It's not necessarily actually taking that path. It's understanding the right path. But sometimes we understand and we have wisdom, but we don't use it. We don't walk that path. Anybody know of a guy who was like that in the Bible? Solomon. Wisest man to ever, and yet made some of the most foolish decisions ever. He had the understanding of the right path, but his heart and will did not desire to walk that path. And so that's one thing I've talked to the kids about in the morning is, look, choosing and knowing the path that God would have you to take, but then praying for the desire and ability to actually make that choice. And so in the book of Proverbs, there's some chapters that talks about the adulterous woman. Try to explain that to a six-year-old. And I'm like, hey, I'm not going to avoid it. And so we just got all into all. No, we didn't. Not ready for it, correct? But having to break it down to the kids and the dangers of those who would entice you and lure you into a different way of life and away from the wise path. And so that's how we dealt with it. And here you have Abraham's the guy who God is calling out of the fallen world and into his special covenant with him. God calls him, he commands him, he gives him a promise. And I never really understood how important Abraham was to the plan of redemption until I read a book called Christ of the Covenants by O. Palmer Robertson. If you want an education in the covenants of God, read that book because it is fascinating. And I started to see that God's promise to Abraham that I will be your God, you will be my people, that the whole New Testament is the fulfillment of God's promise to Abraham. The New Testament is just the Abrahamic covenant played out. It all starts with Abraham. The whole plan of redemption, the seed of Abraham, all that it talks about, he's the father of faith. If you're of faith, you are a son of Abraham. You know the kids' tune? Come on, children's ministry. Father Abraham. Why do they move their arms like this? I don't know. Had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. Come on. Let's all do it together. I'm just kidding. So you do this whole thing, and as a kid, you're thinking, he's not my dad. Who's Father Abraham? He's the father of faith, and we get to actually look at his origin story here on where Abraham came from and who he is. Now, we have to look at Genesis 11, 27 first. Let's look at it. Now, these are the generations of Terah. Terah fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran fathered Lot. We'll break down the family structure in a minute. Haran died in the presence of his father, Terah. That is not a normal thing, is it? It's not the normal course of events, usually, that a parent endures the death of their child. But that is something that happens in our fallen world, correct? Some of you have experienced that in all too real ways. Here, Terah, the father, it says that his son Haran died. We don't know how, but he died in the presence of his father. His dad was there. Okay, that is significant for some reason. So tuck that away for a minute. Verse 28, Haran died in the presence of his father Terah in the land of his kindred in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Abram and Nahor took wives. So two of the sons took wives. Haran, it doesn't mention him taking a wife, does it? Interesting. But we're already told that he had a son named Lot. But we don't hear anything about his wife. We hear about Abram and his wife and Nahor and his wife. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai and the name of Nahor's wife, Milcah. Now this gets a little sketchy for us. Nahor's wife, Milcah, who is she? The daughter of his brother, Haran. That makes Nahor's wife his niece. Ew. Right? But that's what it was at this time. So Nahor marries Milcah, and then we don't hear anything else about them, but we hear about verse 30, and we don't hear about the other daughter, Ishka. So Haran had Lot, Milcah, and Ishka. Now Sarai was barren. She had no child. We know that about her if you've read through the scriptures before. Okay? So they take wives, two of the sons, but Haran, he has three kids, and we never hear about a wife. Why is that? I have no idea, but it seems scandalous, doesn't it? Full on family scandal right there in the pages of scripture, like, ooh, he did wrong, right? And guess who shows up dead? Haran does. Does scripture say that he died because of his extramarital whatever? No, but I don't know. Not a good course of events for Haran. But obviously Terah is grieved and he intends to move away. The place of their kindred, where they were from, Ur of the Chaldeans, Terah decides, I'm leaving. We're getting out of here. So verse 31, Terah took Abram his son and Lot the son of Haran. So he leaves Nahor, Milcah, and Ishka, but he takes Abram and Lot, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. Okay? Look at their goal. Terah's like, I'm going to the land of Canaan. You guys are coming with me. They decide to go to the land of Canaan. That is their goal. But what happens? When they came to Haran, they settled there. A city named Haran. His son who died, his name was Haran. Why is that significant? Because that was the place that Haran had founded his city after his name. Terah goes into that city and he doesn't leave. He doesn't continue going to where he had his heart set on going. He does not go on to the land of Canaan, but he stays in Haran and he dies there. Why is that important? I think Terah settled in grief. I don't think he moved past it. I think he wanted to hold on to his son who he had lost, and he could not continue. So he stayed in a place he never intended to stay in. Do you think that's possible for us to do in our life when we've had loss? To stay in a place we're not supposed to stay in. To be in an environment of grief and being unwilling to move on and go to the place God has placed in our heart to go. Absolutely, it happens. So many people I talk to have some tragedy or trauma in their life, and the hardest thing for them to do is to move out of that environment. I'm not saying move away. Sometimes it is. Moving out of state, moving out of the country. Sometimes it's a place of spiritual and emotional perspective that you are unwilling to let go of that grief and trust that God has other things for you. As if it's betraying the memory of that person to actually be happy again. To go to a new place in your life and a new opportunity. See, maybe Terah felt guilty for moving on to the land of Canaan. He lost his son. He can't leave his city. He can't leave where his kids were or other people. And so then Terah's hindered from moving on to what God would have for him. We got to be careful of those scenarios. And so they settled there. That means Abram settled there. His wife Sarai, verse 32, the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Look at Genesis 12, verse 1. We're going to read this anew right now. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. Okay, let's not look over the fact that God spoke to Abram just now. Right? Do you remember when God spoke to Noah? That wasn't a daily occurrence for him. God spoke and said, I'm not happy with mankind. I'm going to wipe all of them out. But you're going to make an ark, and I'm going to make a covenant with you. Now go do it for 100 years, and then I'll talk to you again. Abram, God speaks to him, and what does he say? Go. Like, God's almost like, I understand why you stayed here thus far. But your dad is dead. Do you think Abram could have stayed in the city of grief just like his father did? His father lost his son and he stayed in that city. Abram lost his dad. He could have stayed in that city of grief. Did he? No. Because God called him to go to the land that he would show him. God said, go from your country, from your kindred, and from your father's house. Do you think that took faith for Abraham to listen to the Lord? Did it take sacrifice? He's going to a foreign land where he knows no one, and he's leaving everything he's ever known to follow the Lord. Have you done that in your life before? It's a pretty unnerving yet really exhilarating time in your life of faith. To trust the Lord in things that really matter, that kind of freak you out if they don't go well. And you step out and you go do what God's calling you to do. Jen and I have had experiences where we felt the Lord leading us and we were at a church in Tustin Ranch and then we're in Hawaii and you're like, oh, that's real rough. But to sell off the condo we had, that if we held on to it, it would have tripled in price 2 years later. But somebody in my family benefited from that. And to move to a place and not have a lot of financial security, but trust the Lord that he's going to take care of you. And then to give that paradise up and move back to continue to follow the Lord in different things. And then moved to Virginia, cross country, thinking it's to serve a church. And we did that, and we also gained two kids in the process. And then to visit California and put an offer on a house and get the house, and we don't know how we got it, and I didn't have a job here yet. And that worked out. And then to get a phone call and say, hey, you want three kids, and then take them all in 24 hours later. And then to be willing to trust the Lord when they say you can't have them anymore and we're going to take them away. And trust that God's going to work in their life and ours. And then when you get the call that you can have them back, and God makes you willing to do it. even though you know it's going to be really hard. There is an aspect of our Christian faith where we have to live on the edge a bit. Think about it. What's the use of faith if you don't ever use it? Now, I'm not promoting foolishness, but sometimes the ways of the Lord are foolishness to others. Sometimes the neat and tidy worldly wisdom way of doing things, God asks you kind of step out of that sometimes and make some pretty bold steps. And you got to be willing to do it. Abram did that. He left. He went from his country to a land that God would show him. And what God was really doing is giving to Abram one of the greatest blessings in all the world. And this was driven home to me when I was watching a movie the other night. It's a reboot of an old Western, The Magnificent Seven. And there's a recent reboot. It was last year. Denzel Washington's in it. And one of the beginning scenes, there's this town called Rose Creek that people came and they sacrificed a lot to settle there. And this rich mining company guy comes in and he starts extorting the people and abusing them in all kinds of ways. And all the good folk of the town are in the church and they're talking about this guy and how he's just stealing their land and he's got the sheriff on his payroll and all these things are going on. And then the doors burst open and armed henchmen walk in, and then this guy walks in behind them shaking a jar of something dark, and the people are just terrified, and he's shaking it, and he gets up behind the pulpit and he starts talking about how in America they've always equated capitalism with godliness, and that he starts shaking the jar. He says, what's in here is your God that you will sacrifice for and die for. And then he calls a little boy up who's absolutely petrified. He unscrews it and he tells the kid to put his hand in there. And the kid goes and he shoves the kid's hand in there. And the kid's kind of freaking out and he has him pull it out. And he says, what is it? The kid goes, land. And he said, that is your God, land. But when I get a hold of it, it's just dirt. And he ends up offering them like a portion of what the money of the land's worth. And anybody who doesn't take his deal, they're going to be killed or kicked out of the town. But land was the thing that people of antiquity throughout history, if you had land, you could sustain yourself. Because it was land that you planted food in, that you had livestock in. That land allowed you to live. You didn't go to the grocery store. Your land was the grocery store. And if you had land, you could provide for your family and generations after you. God is providing for Abram and all his descendants. He is putting a stake in the ground saying, this whole land of Canaan no longer belongs to him. Abram, it will belong to you. And so God put that desire in his heart to finish the mission that his dad Terah had at the beginning. So Abram goes on, not Moses. Verse 2, God now gives him the promise. He tells him where he's going to go, but he gives this promise. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. What do we know about Abram and Sarai in their marriage at this point? She's barren. It's not they don't have kids, which is true, they don't. But she is certifiably barren. Not only that, old. So she was never able to have children, and now she's past the years of childbearing age. And God is saying, Abram, I'm going to make a great nation out of you, i.e., you are going to have children. You are going to have offspring. This was a miraculous promise that would have taken a lot of faith to believe in. That's why Abram ends up being called the father of faith. And we'll get into that passage later. But look at what he says here. He says, I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. Why? So that you will be a blessing. Have you ever thought of the purpose God has in mind for blessing you? Think about it. We want God to bless us, right? We ask for his blessing. We hope for it. And God wants to bless you and I in the ways that he has in mind. But what is his whole purpose? Just to make you happy? His blessing is for your joy. Don't get that confused. But he blesses you so that you can be a blessing to others. Have you ever thought of that? That the whole purpose in him blessing you with the gift of salvation, he shows you grace so that you can go and be a blessing by showing grace to somebody else. You know what's hard to show other people? Grace. You ever thought about that? Because we're really good at holding people accountable to the things they got to do. But when we're not accountable or we fail in our duties, we want a lot of grace. If you've never received God's grace, how can you give it? How can you give grace to somebody who needs it? God gives you grace so then you can take that gift and you could give it to somebody who doesn't deserve it. That's the whole point of grace. Giving it to somebody who doesn't deserve it. Showing love and being a blessing to somebody who needs to be blessed. Somebody who's had a rough life and you see worth and value in them. You see the image of God in them and you seek to show them love and grace in the way God has shown it to you. That's why he saved us, for good works. They don't save us, but man, they're fun to do. Man, it's exciting to be a part of God's work, to participate in his work of redemption in the life of another human being. I mean, think about the times where you stepped out in faith and prayed for somebody personally who needed that prayer. Not, hey, I'm going to pray for you, but hey, let's pray right now. And God uses you in that person's life. Or calling somebody or visiting them, knowing they're struggling. And God using you in their life to encourage them and give them hope. There's nothing better. Verse 3. God says, I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. Let's think about that for a moment. Does God really mean what he's saying? God says to Abram, I will bless whoever blesses you, but anybody who curses you, I will curse them. Did God mean what he was saying? Yeah. So should we really get worked up and worried in the church when somebody says something about us and says evil things about us? If we belong to the Lord, he's like, hey, those who speak well of you, I'm going to bless them. But those who speak nasty, hateful things about you, guess what? God's going to deal with them. And it's okay to take some comfort in that. Do you know that? It's okay. Because God deals with those who are proud or who are fighting against him and his kids. God deals with them pretty severely when you look at the whole testimony of the Old Testament and the New. But keep in mind, God also deals with his children when they disobey his commands. God raised up some of the most wicked people, the Assyrians, and used them to discipline the Israelites because they didn't keep the Sabbath day holy. It was important to the Lord that they would worship him on that day, and they weren't doing it. So there's a lot of things God has done. He disciplines us, but he destroys those who aren't his, who continue in unbelief. And so he's going to bless those who bless Abraham, but curse those who don't. But he says this, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. In Abraham, in his offspring, every nation in all the world, you know, all the nations we studied in the previous chapter that dispersed throughout the world, mankind's all over the world now. God says, I will bless all the nations through you, Abraham. Wow. How does God bless all the nations through Abraham? Somebody say, Jesus. That's my uncle. That was a good answer. That's the reality, is that Jesus is the offspring of Abraham. that God promised. Now let's trace Jesus through the Old Testament for a moment. Genesis 3, the fall happens. God pronounces judgment on the serpent, on Eve, and on Adam in that order. When he judges the serpent, he says, "And this, there will be enmity or war between your seed, the seed of the serpent, and the seed of the woman. You will crush he will crush your head, and you will bruise his heel." Who is the seed of the woman? Jesus. And then we go to Abraham. Who is the offspring of Abraham? It's really not the whole Jewish people. In one sense it is, in another sense it's not. Taken from, I believe it's Galatians 3:17. I just have the verse, I don't have the chapter down. It says, God, in that epistle, Paul writes, it says, "I will surely bless you." Galatians 3:16. "Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring." It does not say "and to offsprings," plural, referring to many, but referring to one. "And to your offspring, who is Christ." The New Testament interprets the Old. It tells us that the whole promise of Abraham, that God would take a people out of fallen humanity, redeem them, make them his own children, that he would do that all through Abraham and specifically his offspring, who is Jesus. Jesus came to make you and I sons and daughters of God, to be taken out of the world, brought into his kingdom and into a relationship with him, that he would bless us with forgiveness of sins, eternal life. And why would God bless us through the seed of Abraham, Christ, in that way? So that you and I can do what Abraham did. Go, obey the command of God, and be a blessing to the people around us. Too many Christians want to be blessed and not be a blessing. Think about that. How would things change in our church, in our families, in our society, if your goal when you wake up in the morning is, "Man, God, I want to thank you for how you've blessed me, and I want to be a blessing to other people. I want to bless them by sharing Christ and his grace and his love with other people around me." That's what he saved us for. We are called to be on a daily mission for Christ. To go, not to the land of Canaan like Abram, but to go and help bring people into the promised land. To go and make disciples of all nations. There it is again. All nations. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We have a job to do, folks. And that job involves having a love for the lost. Wanting people to know Jesus and the blessing of being brought into a relationship with him. But you can't do that if you are not in that relationship. If I'm not, if we aren't enjoying the presence of God and walking in his ways in wisdom and in truth and receiving that blessing from him, we're not going to be a very good blessing to other people, are we? You can only give out what you have received. So receive him. Receive him in faith. Receive the blessing that Christ has for you. And now go give it out. You're not going to run out. That's the mystery of it. The more you give it out, the more it overflows. And that's what God desires for us. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have promised through Abraham that through him all the nations would be blessed. And we know that all the nations have been blessed through Christ, that we are an example of those who are blessed, that we have been brought into your family and your kingdom. And I pray, Father, that we would actively worship you this week. Help us not to go through our week just like the unbelievers do, but help us, Lord, to wake up with a song on our lips and a prayer in our hearts. Help us, Lord, to wake up and have a desire to read your word and to live the rest of our day in obedience to it. And help us, Lord, to see all the blessings we have been given in Christ. And may we be a blessing to all those around us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.